Sangi chudan soki chognam la jang chu badu dagni kyab suchi dagi chen yin gi pen sonam gi drola penchu sangi drupashu sangi chudan soki chognam la jang chu badu dagni kyab suchi dagi chen yin gi pen sonam gi drola penchu sangi drupashu sangi chudan soki chognam
Okay, hi, good morning, everybody. So let's just start with a couple of minutes meditation on the breath. Mm. So I think the purpose of my life is to lead all sentient beings from suffering to enlightenment. In order to do that, first I have to reach enlightenment myself, and that depends upon completing the entire path to enlightenment. And completing the path to enlightenment depends upon studying the teachings on the path to enlightenment, meditating on them and realizing them. Therefore, to begin that process, I'm going to study the first Path to Enlightenment text, Atisha's Lamp for the Path to Enlightenment, and some of the commentaries we have. So I'm studying these teachings in order to reach enlightenment, in order to become a Buddha, for the sake of all sentient beings. So, you know, remembering the beginninglessness and the vast extent of the suffering we've experienced ourselves throughout beginningless lives in samsara, and generate compassion for all sentient beings who are experiencing that also, especially those who are now in the lower realms. And even in the upper realms, where even, you know, here on Earth, which is supposed to be a good place, relatively speaking, there's, you know, the war in Ukraine and so many other sufferings all over. I just feel compassion for those who are experiencing suffering, for those who are inflicting suffering. At least those who are experiencing suffering are finishing that karma. Those who are inflicting suffering are just beginning that karma. So feeling a suffering and generating compassion. I think, you know, I must reach enlightenment as quickly as possible, no matter how difficult it is, no matter how long it takes, in order to alleviate the suffering of all sentient beings. So we should, you know, generate that compassion, feel that compassion in our heart, and then radiate it out infinitely in all directions. Okay, thank you. So you'll have to excuse me if I'm a bit more out of it than usual. As some of you know, Wendy, my wife, is she's in the air on her way to Los Angeles, on her way to Australia, The flight was supposed to be at 6 p.m. today. So, and I was going to take it to the airport around 3 or something, you know. Then the airline switched the flight to 6 a.m. this morning. So so then she had this plan. Rather than make me get up at 3 and drive out of the airport this morning, she booked a hotel near the airport, and one of our friends gave her 1 million air miles so that to pay for her flight and a couple of hotels on the way. So so she decided to stay in, you know, we go to the hotel yesterday evening and, you know, have a date night and maybe watch a movie and relax in the hotel room. And then she go to sleep and then get up and go to the airport around 4 or 5. But she misjudged how long it would take to pack. So we finally left home about 1 a.m. So she got about 3 hours in the hotel, if that. And I guess she got up because I haven't heard she missed the flight. So so operating on a little less sleep than usual. But okay, now I've got the next 2 months home alone without adult supervision. So this is party central. Just come any time, any day. It's all happening here. All right, now, so we were talking last time about meditation, developing concentration. So I thought I'd just jump back and review what Sokhon Rinpoche said, and then I'll have a look at what Khunu Lama Rinpoche said about these verses. So we got up to verse 40, I think. 38, 39, 40. So just to review a little bit before that, and then we'll catch up. So this is to do with developing higher concentration. So Tenchab Sekon Rinpoche said, to be able to benefit others and work for their sakes, it's very important to have advanced awareness, ESP, extrasensory perception. Not EST. The name of the guy who started that, ESP. Without this, it's very difficult to really be of benefit. So that's, you know, quite a big statement there. That, you know, we think we're benefiting others, we generate bodhicitta, we meditate, and we give stuff away, and we do all different things, you know, but without advanced awareness, extrasensory perceptions, very difficult to really be of benefit. So that's a little sort of back to reality thought. For instance, one time a fish jumped out of a river and someone came along and put it back in the water. Although this person had a kind heart with very good motivation, wanting to benefit this fish, he didn't have advanced awareness, so he couldn't see what was in the water. When he put the fish back in the water, it was quickly devoured and eaten up by some larger carnivorous fish. If we really wish to help others with compassion, then it's very important to have advanced awareness, because if we don't, we could make many disastrous mistakes like this. So I guess the point is that not to leave the fish on dry land, but to put it in a bucket of water and take it to some other place where there wasn't a carnivorous fish. As Lama Zopa Rinpoche tells a story of one time when he was in Singapore, and the students at the Amitabha Buddha Center there, this is one of their common practices, liberating animals. You know, we haven't done it for a while at Kurukulla, I guess because of the pandemic, but you know, we used to do this lobster thing, and we've done it many times. Of course, we don't know what, so we, you know, we buy all these lobsters, and then people say, oh, you shouldn't buy the lobsters because you're just encouraging the lobster fishermen to fish more. They're going to fish whether we buy them or not. And we just have to think about these particular lobsters in front of us. So we buy these lobsters. And then what Rinpoche says the most important part is to give them Dharma imprints. So we set up this altar, you know, with something, with all these holy objects. So we have this little table here in front of our main altar. And in that wicker box, there's all kinds of precious holy objects. And there's a set of cards made by the Amitabha Buddhist Center with 100,000 images on it there. You can't see it, it's behind there. I don't know if we have one of those sets at the center. So the most important part is to give the lobsters or whoever, whichever animals we're liberating, the Dharma imprints, so that even if they die soon after we liberate them, at least they've got these Dharma imprints and they've made a connection with the Dharma. So we circumambulate them, and then we splash them with blessed water and recite mantras and prayers so they can hear, you know. So there's one monk in Singapore who's actually, he's been doing this long before he became a monk. He was actually a commando in the Singapore army. And and he got into, maybe 20 years or more, maybe more than 20 years ago, he got into organizing the animal liberations in Singapore. And they've liberated well over 200 million animals in Singapore over this time. He had a beautiful wife, and they were a really attractive young couple. They didn't have kids. And tragically, his wife died around the age of 40 from a ruptured aneurysm in her brain. So then he became a monk. And he's been spending a lot of time in Nepal in retreat. Anyway, so Rinpoche was there during one of these animal liberations, and then afterwards they went to a restaurant to have dinner or something, and there was a snake in a kind of glass enclosure waiting for somebody to order up, you know, roast snake or however they cook it. And so they thought they should liberate this snake from being killed. But then Rinpoche was saying that they bought the snake and then they took it out into the forest to liberate it. But then he thought, well, all the snake is going to do is start slithering around and eating mice or other sentient beings. So he might have benefited the snake by liberating it, but what about all the mice that the or whatever else the snake is going to eat? So this is, you know, symbolic of the hopelessness of samsara. You know, and if you had higher perception, maybe you could see that, well, that snake is going to be killed and eaten, but with my extrasensory perception, I can see that the snake is going to be reborn in the upper realms if that happens. So better just leave it, you know. So I'm not saying, well, you know, so Rinpoche may have that higher perception. He thought it's better to liberate the snake that way, but he just pointed out the dilemma. So anyway, the conclusion is the only way to really benefit sentient beings is to escape from cyclic existence altogether. And from that sort of vantage point, then help bring other sentient beings out of samsara. Otherwise, as long as we're in samsara, you know, we alleviate one suffering and then another one takes its place. So I don't think that's to say we shouldn't do anything because we don't know what's going to happen. So with as much wisdom as we have and with as much compassion as we have, we should free animals from suffering. And that's part of the practice of the first perfection, the perfection of perfection of giving, perfection of generosity, the perfection of charity, whatever you call it. That practice is, you know, the different kinds of practice of charity. The second one is practice of what they call giving fearlessness, you know, saving sentient beings, you know, like a fly caught in a spider's web or an insect drowning in a puddle of water, something like that. There are many ways of doing that. So then Sepa Rinpoche says, the method for developing advanced awareness is to develop a stilled and settled mind of shamatha, calm abiding, shine in Tibetan. We talked a lot about that in the chart last week, didn't we? We did. The method for developing, this is what we need to develop first. So Atisha states, so this is going back just a fraction to read these verses again, 34. As for the cause that will fully complete these networks, this is a different translation. This is Alex Berzin's translation, which is different from Ruth Sonam's that we usually use. As for the cause that will fully complete these networks, having the nature of positive force and deep awareness, all the Buddhas have asserted that it is the development of advanced awareness. That's the cause that will fully complete these networks having the nature of positive force and deep awareness. Not sure how he's, what he's translating as positive force. Maybe bodhicitta. Anyway, just as a bird without fully developed wings cannot fly in the sky, likewise lacking the force of advanced awareness, you'll be unable to fulfill the aims of limited beings. Whatever positive force is had in a day and a night by someone possessing, so positive force, it must mean merit. Whatever merit is had in a day, is created in a day and night by someone possessing advanced awareness, is not had even in 100 lifetimes by someone lacking advanced awareness. So that, you know, higher perception or clairvoyance or ESP. We can create more merit in 24 hours than someone who doesn't have ESP can do it in 100 lifetimes. So that's, you know, pretty good commercial for Shine right there. Therefore, if we wish to fully and quickly complete our network of positive potential, or what we would say normally our accumulation of merit for total enlightenment, we should make effort and thereby come to achieve advanced awareness. Advanced awareness is not to be had by the lazy. Atisha states, 37, therefore, if you would wish to fully complete quickly the networks for total enlightenment, that's interesting. He translates the accumulation, I think, as network. Alex does have his, I don't know if you've looked at the Berzin archives, now it's called studybuddhism.com. There's incredible teachings there. And, you know, over the years, Alex is one of the first Western students in Dharamsala. He got his PhD at Harvard. And I think he went there as part of his studies in 69. And he started working around the time the Library of Tibetan Works and Archives started. You know, he studied Tibetan and Sanskrit and got involved in translating and publishing. He worked a lot back then with John Landau. John was an excellent editor. And he's edited a bunch of Lama Yeshe's teachings, especially the book Introduction to Tantra. So John is an excellent editor, and they worked together. They were friends from Paterson, New Jersey. But Alex has his own terminology, as you'll notice if you go to his website, studybuddhism.com. Therefore, if you would wish to fully complete quickly the accumulations for enlightenment, make effort and thereby come to attain advanced awareness. It is not to be had by the lazy. So, anyway, similar to the translation of Ruth Sonam, of course. 38, someone who has not achieved a stilled, settled mind will not attain advanced awareness. Therefore, repeatedly exert effort to actualize a stilled, settled mind. So, stilled, settled mind. So that's shamatha or calm abiding. The Tibetan word is shine, you know, so shi means peace and ne means to abide. Calm, so we translate as calm abiding, shine, peaceful abiding mind. A stilled and settled state of shamatha is necessary to gain advanced awareness. And in general, it's absolutely necessary to have this state of absorbed concentration, samadhi, or single-pointed concentration, in order to attain Buddhahood. This is something that we should not neglect. If we don't know the methods for achieving single-pointed, absorbed concentration, even if we practice for 1,000 years, we won't be able to attain it, if we don't know the methods. Therefore, it's extremely important to know the proper methods. If we do and we practice properly, then it's possible to attain this state within 6 months. So I think last time I said, some teachers say 9 to 12 months, but here he's saying 6 months. If we know the proper methods and we practice properly. The methods for achieving a stilled and settled mind of shamatha include many different objects that we can use as the focus. However, regardless of what we use, there are specific methods and techniques for achieving this state. In future, you should ask various learned geshes for the complete instructions on how to achieve it. Practitioners can make many mistakes and have a lot of confusion without the proper methods. So one of the learned geshes that we can ask is Geshe Zopa, and there's this book, which is volume 4 of the 5-volume series of his Geshe Rinpoche's commentary on Lamrim Chemo, great treatise. So so this is it's actually about half the size of all the other, each of the other volumes, but incredibly detailed instructions for developing single-pointed concentration. So I don't think I'll read the whole thing to you, but highly recommended, Wisdom Publications. Atisha says, however, should the factors for a still settled mind, calm abiding, be weak, then even if you have meditated with great effort, and even if for thousands of years you will not attain single-minded concentration, therefore maintain well the factors mentioned in the chapter on a network for single-minded concentration. So as I mentioned before, well, here Ruth translates a collection for meditative stabilization. So when we look in the footnotes, all it does is Yeah, we read this last time. It's by Bodhi Bhadra, so who succeeded Naropa as the northern doorkeeper. We talked all about that. So all it does is mention who wrote that text, Bodhi Bhadra. But I don't know. I don't think it's been translated into English. There's a lot hasn't been translated into English. So maintain well the factors mentioned in the chapter on network single-minded concentration, then place your mind on something constructive, namely one of the appropriate objects of focus. If we then, Rinpoche says, if we develop absorbed concentration, it will be easy to develop advanced awareness. So if we develop calm abiding, we'll then be able to develop single point of concentration, which is taking it further. You know, it's you know, like stages 10 and 11 in the chart we were looking at. Okay, so that's Sekong Rinpoche. Khunu Lama Rinpoche says, without reading the root text, just going back to his commentary on verses 32 to 35, the best way to keep our three doors pure, our body, speech, and mind pure, is to generate aspirational bodhicitta, engage in the practice of bodhicitta, and follow the path to enlightenment. This depends on observing the three levels of moral conduct, pranimoksha, bodhisattva, and tantric powers. If we do this properly, we can complete the two collections of merit and transcendent wisdom, you know, the two wings of the bird. One thing that really helps us complete these two collections is the ability to foresee the future. Therefore, we should try to acquire clairvoyance. Without it, we are like a baby bird whose wings are undeveloped and has not yet grown feathers and remains stuck in its nest, unable to fly. So that's us. Without clairvoyance, we cannot work for other sentient beings. I'd say these are interpretive statements, not definitive. A person, then 36, 37, a person who has achieved psychic power to foresee the future can create more merit in a day than a person without this ability can create in 100 years. Therefore, to complete the collections of merit and transcendent wisdom quickly, it's necessary to acquire the psychic power to see past, present, and future. In order to do this, it's necessary to achieve single point of concentration. For this, we must understand the details of the method of attaining samadhi, such as the nine stages, the six powers, and the four mental engagements. So there's just a reference to His Holiness's, His Holiness's book, Opening the Eye of New Awareness, has very nice explanation of some of these different points, nine stages, six powers, and four mental engagements. Anyway, I don't have time to look at that now. Verse 39, this is Khunu Lama Rinpoche's commentary. In order to practice samadhi meditation properly, we must ensure that the conditions are perfect. If they are not, then even though we try practicing it hard for even 1,000 years, we'll never achieve it. Therefore, we should find the perfect environment, remain quiet, and avoid having to do work such as healing the ill and making astrological predictions. Any activity that keeps us busy. I don't know if anyone here is busy making astrological predictions, but that's one of the things that would be a hindrance to achieving single point of concentration. And then the last verse we got up to, verse 40, Khunu Lama Rinpoche says, the way to meditate to attain single point of concentration is to focus our mind on a virtuous object, such as an image of the Buddha. We talked about that last time. We visualize such an image in front of us and simply concentrate on that. As we focus our mind on the object again and again, we'll be able to hold it strongly for increasingly greater periods of time. And through the continuity of such practice, we'll eventually gain calm abiding, attain calm abiding and single point of concentration. Thus, we will gain higher seeing, the psychic power to see future and so forth. Then he starts his commentary on the next couple of verses by saying, but that is not the point. That is not the point. Just to attain psychic power, we have to use that for higher purposes. Okay, so that's just what Khunu Lama Rinpoche and Tenchab Sirkhan Rinpoche had to say about those last few verses in the 30s. So then we started talking about verse 40, and there's quite a lot of commentary on that verse by Geshe Sonam Rinchen. So we got up to the bit on page 96, if you have this book, where he says, in the great exposition of the stages of the path, Lamrim Chemo, six main conditions for developing calm abiding are mentioned. The first is to stay in a conducive place. The ornament for the Mahayana sutras, that's, Sangha Maitreya's text, Mahayana Sutra Alamkara, that says, in an intelligent person's place of practice, things are well found, the site is good, the ground is good, there are good friends, and the tools for a practitioner's happiness. So I'm not sure if this would refer to, our daily life practice, or it more refers to when we're going into retreat. I mentioned last time that it's important to spend certain periods of time in retreat, whether it's 10 days or a month or 3 months or 3 years, whatever we can swing. Lama Yeshe used to say that we should all plan to do 1 month retreat every year. I don't know if anyone's been able to do that in among the people he told that to. I certainly haven't. Of course, it's in my hands. It's in the hands of each of us, how we spend our time and how we assess our priorities. So now looking back, 40, 50 years, I wish I'd taken Lama's advice. I think my mind would be in a much better place if I'd done a month's retreat every year. But, there's always so much to do, and it's so busy, and we just don't make time. So I haven't done that much retreat. I've done 2-3 month retreats and a number of 1 month retreats and a couple of 6 week retreats over the years. It's not really enough. I never found it easy to meditate. I always found external busy work came more easily. So I kind of, like water finding the easiest path. That's kind of what I've done. But now, you know, we have, it's easy to do, to find a place to do retreat. You know, we have Milarepa Center, just 2-3 hours away. And then we have the Land of Calm Abiding in California. And we have, you know, retreat centers in Asia. We have Tushita Meditation Center, and we have Laudo Retreat Center, and even Copan, you can do retreat there, even though it's not far from Kathmandu. There are plenty of places to do retreat, and plenty of experienced teachers to guide us. So, so it's something we should think of, take seriously. You know, I wish I'd done more. It should be a place. So now the place. It should be a place in which basic necessities like food and water can be easily and ethically procured. For example, the things provided by a benefactor should have been honestly acquired. Otherwise, our practice may be adversely affected. I think I read that last time. A good place is one in which other great practitioners have practiced. Their blessings have turned it into a power place, which can then empower us. And through our practice, we in turn empower it. A sacred site of this kind imparts a feeling of peace and well-being. Recently, people have recognized the great importance of preserving such places from desecration, wherever they may be in the world. Places of conflict and those where massacres or calamities have occurred are best avoided and not treated as a challenge. If there are non-human spirits present where we wish to practice, it's better to befriend them than to expel them by fierce means. So this is not something that's part of our normal consciousness about what spirits are around. You know, are they helpful or harmful? We don't really know what they are. Some we may not even know, be convinced that spirits exist. But you know, the lamas have so many practices to do with spirits that I think we have to, you know, our ignorance notwithstanding, I think we have to, I'm going to say, take the existence of spirit seriously. You know, there's one time I can't remember when it was. I think it must have been probably 2004, 2005. We went to Milarepa Center to do with Geshe Tsulga to do Vajrayogini retreat. I don't think Deborah came. I don't know if anyone else was around then. About 10 of us went up there to do retreat. I think Annie Yeshi was just been ordained. So whenever that was, 2005, 2006, Geshe Tenley was there. And anyway, there were about 8 or 10 of us. And so the retreat was in the Milarepa Center Gompa, which is the kind of attic on top of the main house there. And some people stayed in the house, and but I had a tent that I set up just a little bit away from the house. And the first night in the tent, I couldn't sleep. it was just so, I just couldn't sleep. You know, every time I let my mind was like kind of shaking a little bit, you know. And so then I thought, oh, well, you know, new place, new, just a bit of a change of scene. So, I'll get used to it. So then the next night, again, yeah, so then we do like four sessions a day, as usually you do in retreat. And and I can't remember if Geshe-la did this, but often you'll see before initiations, the lamas do this gektor, which gek means hindrances or obstructors, which are negative spirits. So a gektor, you know, they have this little plate with three little tormas on it, you know, these ritual cakes, and each one has a candle or a tea light in front of it. And then they do this practice, and it's offering, transforming these three tormas into whatever the spirits of the area need. And so you visualize offering this ritual cake, these ritual cakes to the spirits, and you know, and then the lama chants the offering text, and you visualize that these tormas transform into whatever it is that spirits need to be satisfied, and they receive this, and then they go away, they just disappear across the horizon, fully satisfied. And you know, you pray, ask them to please let us do this practice, and to let the practice be successful, and please don't interfere. So the interferers, so they go away satisfied. So that's the little ritual that they do before initiation, and before other important things too. So I don't remember if Geshe-la did this practice. Did the gektor? I don't think he did. So then the second night, again, I couldn't sleep. And then again, the third night. And it was like a 10 or 12 day retreat. So, you know, I thought, oh, this is hopeless. So I went to tell Geshe, look, I haven't been able to sleep. I'm totally wired now. And I think I better give up and go back to Boston and try again another time. And Geshe said, no, let's, I think, let me try this first. So then they did this, I don't know, can't remember what the practice is called, but you make a little effigy of like a person out of sampa, and then you take it to, you know, the crossroads or to a sort of a little busy place outside. Well, Milarepa Center, there's no crossroads or busy place outside, but there's the road that comes in. So we put this little effigy, I don't think it was an effigy of me. And then Geshe-la did this practice to attract the spirits into this thing, and then they take it away or they destroy it. I can't remember what happened exactly. But at the same time, so I thought maybe I put my tent at a place that belongs to a local spirit, and I'm sort of in this spirit's space, so it's just trying to tell me however it can that I should go away. So then I packed up my tent, then I went inside and slept in the dormitory, and then it was okay. So I don't know whether it was moving or whether it was Geshe-la's practice or combination of both or what, but so then I was able to sleep and then do the retreat. So I, you know, at the time I thought I somehow this was a spirit interfering with me and I was in the wrong place. you know, and there are spirits, there are nagas and spirits that live in trees. So they ask permission if they want to chop down a tree. And if they're building, like when we built the stupa at Kurukulla Center, there was a ground blessing. I don't know if anyone was there for that. We had the monks come from Namgyal Monastery in Ithaca, New York, and they came and did a special preparation of the ground. And there's a special one for building a Kalachakra stupa. So these monks, a couple of monks, were expert in that. If you've seen the video on YouTube of how to build a stupa, it's called, there's a video there. I guess it's on the Kurukulla YouTube channel, how to build a stupa. And we videoed the whole thing from that ground blessing up to completing the stupa. If you haven't seen that, you should have a look. So that's asking permission for any spirits that occupy that land, if we can use that land for a beneficial purpose, and please don't interfere. So it took a little while and took a lot of money, but the stupa got built. So I guess that that part was successful too.
Nick, wouldn't the fact that you were disturbed by these spirits indicate that you had some sort of extrasensory perception?
I didn't perceive anything. It was just my surmise. It was just my thinking about it, you know, and I didn't see any spirits, and I'm just making a bit of an assumption that that's what happened. But you know, to have extrasensory perception, as they keep saying here, you need to shamatha, single pointed concentration. And you know, I find it hard to concentrate on my breath for 2 minutes. So I think, as Lama Yeshe would say, you know, long way, baby. Long way, baby. You've come a long way, baby, but baby, you've got a long way to go. A good place is one in which other great practitioners have practiced. Their blessings have turned it into a power place, which can then empower us. And through our practice, we in turn empower it. A sacred site of this kind imparts a feeling of peace and well-being. Recently, people have recognized the great importance of preserving such places from desecration, whether they're in the world. Right, so I did all that. Better to befriend them than expel them by fierce means. Right. The place we choose should be healthy and suit our constitution. For beginners, the presence of supporting friends who share the same outlook and lifestyle is better than complete isolation. Good companions act as an inspiration and encouragement, but don't indulge our whims. We also need the equipment, or as it says in the text, you know, tools for practitioner's happiness. What is that? We must study and listen to teachings, receive the necessary initiations and instructions on the practice we intend to do, and dispel doubts so as to gain a sound understanding. Without this, our meditation will not be fruitful. On the other hand, doing only this without meditating will not bring about any change at all. The second condition is to have few desires. So these are the six conditions, right? Few desires. If we are preoccupied with owning good things and many of them, our energy and thoughts will be devoted to acquiring and taking care of them, leaving little time for the development of concentration. So right place, few desires. The third condition is a cultivation of contentment with what we have. The more we have, the more we become servants to our possessions, which is an obstacle to the practice of meditation. The fourth condition is to maintain pure ethics. To develop a calmly abiding mind, we must overcome the most subtle mental distractions, which cannot be done unless we stop grosser kinds of distraction. This demands control of our physical and verbal behavior. By practicing restraint from faulty actions, we strengthen our conviction regarding the connection between actions and their effects, and become someone others can trust. So, you know, as I've mentioned many times, I think, seems many times, the first retreat I did was the Vajrasattva retreat in 1974. And that was the, we received the initiation into the highest yoga tantra aspect of Vajrasattva, Haruka Vajrasattva. And from Lama Yeshe, and Haruka was Lama's heart practice, and he based the sadhana he created for us on the Vajrasattva practice from the Chakrasamvara Tantra. Then he elaborated, modified, expanded the practice gradually over the next couple of years. And we published it. So he gave us this initiation. So a whole bunch of us got ordained in Bodh Gaya in January 74. And then we came back to Copan, and Lama gave us teaching, and we received Kala Chakra initiation. So that was our first. For many of us, that was our first highest yoga tantra initiation. And then on that basis, Lama was able to give us the highest yoga tantra initiation of Haruka Vajrasattva. And so Lama gave us teachings on tantric vows when we got back to Copan. And there was the sixth meditation course. And then Lama Yeshe gave us the Vajrasattva initiation. And then there was a group retreat at Copan. I think about 20 people, 15, 20 people did that, being led by Canadian nun, Anila Ann. And others of us, probably about 10 or 12 others, mostly monks and nuns, a couple of lay people, went into the mountains to different places. Most of us went to Lado, to Lama Zopa Rinpoche's place. So some did retreat in Rinpoche's house, which was a little way away from the Gompa. And some, I don't think anyone, no, nobody did retreat in the Gompa, because the young Copan monks were there, their school was there. So they'd come up from Kathmandu to spend the summer at Lado in Lado Gompa. One monk did his retreat in the nunnery, Tamo Nunnery, down the hill from Lado, and some people, a couple of guys, Peter and Harvey, did retreat in a house in Mende, which is a little flat area that's down the hill from Lado. It's where the helicopters land now. We didn't have helicopters then. When Rinpoche comes, he often comes by helicopter, it lands there in Mende. Or it did. So anyway, we were all over doing this month retreat, and I did my retreat in a cave, a Charok cave, which had been a meditation cave used by Charok Lama, who was a local Lama in that local area. There's a Lada Gompa here, and the Charok house there, and then the Charok cave a little bit 15-20 minutes away from the Lao Dai Gompa, and then down the hill a bit was this house, Ginupa House, which is where I'd stayed with a few people in the previous year in 73, the first time I went to Lao Dai. So this cave was very isolated and had been used by previous meditators, so it met that requirement. And, I've often said it was those 4 or 5 months I spent in that cave was the best time of my life, without question. Just an amazing time. So in terms of meeting basic necessities, I bought a bunch of food up, sort of non-perishables, rice and sampa and potatoes. I bought up from Kathmandu and dal, lentils. I took precepts every day, so I only ate one meal a day. And I paid one of the nuns from the Tamo nunnery. They call it something else now, I can't remember. This was a bunch of nuns who'd come out of Tibet. They'd followed a lama out of Tibet, and they'd settled here on the mountain, just below Lao Dai, between Lao Dai and the village where Rinpoche was born, Tangme. And there might have been 20 or 30 of them from there. They love to do nyungne, and you can hear them. There's a recording of them doing nyungne somewhere. And in those days, Rinpoche would often try to get up to Lao Dai for Sakadawa and then do a nyungne at Lao Dai Gompa. In the 70s, this happened mainly. I think I did 2 or 3 nyungnes with Rinpoche up there with the Tamo nuns. And they had the most beautiful chanting, and Thupten Pende, the monk, he did his retreat down there in the nunnery. So I asked one of the nuns to shop for me. So every 2 weeks, she would go to the, every Saturday morning, she would go to the market at Namche Bazaar, which for us was, a 3-hour walk. For the Sherpas was probably half that time, 90 minutes. So she'd go to the market and she'd bring back fresh vegetables, which would last 4 or 5 days, and curd, yogurt, fresh yogurt, that would last about 5 minutes. I would leave a list by the gate. So this cave, it's not like you think of a cave wasn't like, anyone watch the film called The Rescue on Netflix? These young Thai kids, the soccer team that got trapped in the cave 3 years ago maybe, and how they rescued them. It wasn't a cave like that where you had to kind of spelunk. In fact, a lot of the caves in that area, also Rinpoche's cave at Lao Dai a little bit, in times past, pieces of rock would break off the cliff. And in fact, you had to cross this mini, to get from Lao Dai Gompa to the Charok cave, you had to cross this kind of mini avalanche. There was this gouge down the mountain full of rocks that had some previous time had fallen down the mountain and gouged this path, which was full of smaller rocks all the way down to the river at the bottom of the valley. So sometimes large chunks would break off and they'd tumble down the mountain and somehow kind of get wedged in the ground. And then there'd be these rocks like this, wedged in the ground and pretty firmly embedded. And then people who wanted to use that space under the rock would then build with rocks like walls and the front and maybe make a door, you know. So that was some of the so-called caves were really built like that. They weren't like a hole in a cliff face or something like that, either natural or created. So the Charak cave was kind of a luxury cave, you know, 4 stars I'd give it, in that it had, a front wall, the sides had been built up with stones, and then it had a wooden front with a window and a door, and the wooden floor had been put in, and a partition, so between the meditation space and the living space, there was a wall, and with a door, and in the living space is where I had my mattress, and there was a stove, like a clay stove, built in there. And then outside, there was a wall built around the outside, so there was this tiny little garden in front, not that anything was growing in it much, and then there was a gate. I have a photo of it, but not handy. So I'd leave a list, shopping list at the gate, and then this nun would come and leave my stuff and then pick up the note for the following 2 weeks. So that went on for months. Tsultim Dolma, she was really amazing. Her brother was a monk at Copan, and he was one of the 2 top meditators, Tsultim Gyaltsen, but he went crazy. Some people said he got occupied by a spirit. And he died quite young. I don't remember if he killed himself or he had an accident. I think he used to have seizures. Anyway, he was one of the 2 top debating monks, but then somehow something happened to his mind. And so his sister was the one who looked after me. So as it says, you know, food and water. So water, there was a spring just up the mountain. And as the summer went on, the little stream dried up more and more. So I had to go further and further up the mountain to get water, and I had a biscuit tin, large biscuit tin that fit into my backpack, so I'd go up and fill that. So as the summer, so every few days or once a week, I'd have to go and get water for drinking and for the water bowls. So I had to keep going further and further up the mountain to collect water. But it lasted the whole time. And it was, you know, just fresh, pure spring water, beautiful, really excellent water. And then the area itself, a lot of the time it was misty, the clouds would come, but other times the sun would shine, and we were on the mountain, and then the mountain went all the way down to a river, and then on the other side there was even higher mountains with snow mountains that you'd look out across onto, and beautiful wildflowers grew in the area, and then so every couple of weeks there'd be a new crop of wildflowers, so it was really amazing to be able to pick those and offer them, these beautiful flowers on the altar. And for most of the time, I didn't, all the time, really, I didn't see anybody or speak to anybody. Every now and then you'd hear clang, clang, clang as some guy took some yaks nearby, leading some yaks somewhere. So, you know, it was a place where a great practitioner had practiced. I don't think I did much to enhance the place, but and there was pure water, the food was easily obtained, just leave a note at the front gate. And so it was a perfect place, I'd say, for retreat. The second condition about having fewer desires, I don't know if I really met that requirement. Maintaining pure ethics. Well, I'd just become a monk, and there wasn't really anybody, any other sentient beings around to talk to or to create negative karma with. So it was relatively easy to be disciplined in that environment, especially being by yourself, not speaking or interacting with others. The fifth condition is to give up busyness. It's obvious that if we have a heavy schedule and many appointments to keep, our time is taken up with conversation. As has already been mentioned, what I wanted to say was the previous thing he says, by practicing restraint from faulty actions, we strengthen our conviction regarding the connection between actions and their effects and become someone others can trust. So Lama Yeshe gave us a commentary on the practice as well as the initiation and putting together a practice for us to do. We published in this book, Becoming Vajrasattva. And I remember, I can hear him saying it even now, nearly 50 years later. And he finished his teaching by saying, just relax and have great faith in Guru Haruka Vajrasattva and Karma. So I'd never heard it quite expressed, to have faith in Karma. And that's what Geshe Sonam Rinchen says here. By practicing restraint, we strengthen our conviction regarding the connection between actions and their effect. So, you know, we develop faith in karma and become someone others can trust. So that was interesting to hear them both say it. As has already been mentioned, the physical and mental busyness this generates in dealing with others acts as an obstacle to meditation. So that's the fifth condition, give up busyness. Well, up there in the mountains, living in a cave by yourself, you know, you could be busy, but there's not really that much to do. So I'd get up in the morning, get up at 3 or 4. I didn't have an alarm clock, but I figured out that if I had a drink of tea around 7 p.m., that at 3 or 3.30, I'd need to get up for a pee. So that was my internal alarm clock. So get up, set up the altar, do some prostrations, and then take precepts, and then do my first session before dawn. And then for breakfast, I just have tea. I didn't eat breakfast. I was keeping precepts fairly strictly, which is just only eating at lunchtime. And you know, there's an exception. There are ways of taking, the proper way to take precepts is not to have breakfast. But often the lamas give us dispensation, especially if we're taking precepts and in a non-retreat situation. At Copan, at the courses, when they take precepts for the last 2 weeks, people really want breakfast, they can have it, but the majority of people don't have breakfast either. And taking precepts and having breakfast, we call them wussets, precepts for wusses. So don't be a wuss. You know, if you take precepts, just have the one meal a day. So I had tea in the morning, black tea, you know, without milk. And then I do my next session, the second of four sessions between breakfast and lunch. And then I have to make a fire. So sometimes, you know, it was summer, but it's not like a hot, dry summer. It's a damp, cloudy summer up there in the high mountains. And the wood would sometimes be a little damp. But anyway, I would make a fire every day in this little stove in the cave. And then I'd boil a big pot of water. And then I'd use water to make lunch. For maybe a month or 6 weeks, there were nettles growing there. So, you know, you could kind of do a milarepa trip and eat nettles, as well as, and like I said, the vegetables that they bought from the market didn't last that long. So, they were supplemented by nettles. And then I'd make some kind of, and I had potatoes and rice and then sampa. So I'd make some kind of soupy mess that would serve as lunch. But then I'd also make, I had a big Chinese thermos that I'd fill with water. And then I'd use that to make afternoon tea and then my alarm clock tea at 7 p.m. And then it would last. It was a little cool by breakfast, but then I had by breakfast tea. And so I only had to make one fire a day. So I made water to last 24 hours and used that. And then I cooked lunch as well. So, you know, that routine went on for months. And then there's the afternoon. So then I'd read. So Lama Yeshe in his retreat instructions says you can read, you know, can read Dharma books if you're reading in retreat. So I mainly lamrim. So I had Edward Conze's translation of The Perfection of Wisdom in 8,000 lines. So I would read that. And then I had the Copan course notes from previous courses. So I would also read Rinpoche's Lamrim teachings. And then we'd do the afternoon session and then break at five or so for tea and then do the next session. So you're not supposed to meditate at sunrise or sunset. Somehow the energy isn't right at those times for meditation. And up there in the mountains, the sun goes down behind the high mountains, so it becomes evening fairly quickly. So then I'd do the evening session, and then I'd go to sleep around nine, I guess. And then again the next morning, get up at 3 or 3:30, whatever my bladder told me. So like that. So four sessions a day. So give up busyness. The sixth condition is to give up desire for sense stimuli because it prevents us from turning our attention inwards. If we can create these conducive inner and outer conditions and then practice in the correct way, the result will follow automatically. Without them, our hopes are in vain. Even if we don't intend to practice intensively in order to develop calm abiding, these prerequisites provide useful guidelines for a good and wholesome way of life. So it can make our whole life a retreat, sort of. So, as well as giving a commentary on the Vajrasattva practice, Lama gave some really valuable retreat instructions in his teachings as well. I think he gave six teachings altogether, and the last one and a half were on retreat. So in this book, there are three chapters on retreat. There's one called Getting Ready for Retreat. There's another called the Details of the Retreat Session. And then there's more general retreat advice. So I don't know, has anyone here done a long retreat, 3 months at least? Deborah? Anyway, it's something for your bucket list to do a 3-month retreat, just to have that experience. And especially if you can do a Vajrasattva retreat. I think there's a group retreat started a month or so ago at Copan, so you can do a group retreat. Tushita Meditation Center in Dharamsala, I don't know if they ran for years and years. Group Vajrasattva retreat. I don't know if they still do or not. There used to be a small group retreat, just 2 or 3 people at Milarepa Center in the winter for a few years. They did that back in the 90s. And, you know, if a bunch of Kurukulla people wanted to organize a 3-month retreat at Milarepa Center, that could probably be done. And then, as I mentioned, you can do an individual retreat. Sometimes it's better if you haven't done a longish retreat, even a month, to retreat with maybe another person or a small group of people or a large group of people. But group retreats are useful because everybody has to come to every session. And they generally make the rule that if somebody's missing, the session can't start. So you know that if you don't come to the session, other people aren't going to be able to do it. So unless you're sick or something, you've received dispensation, and everybody knows, then you really have to attend every session. And that's kind of an important part of retreat. You know, like as Lama says somewhere, you've got a headache, you don't want to do retreats. A little headache isn't going to kill you. So Lama says, what the qualifications for retreat are, what qualifications are necessary for a person to retreat on the highest yoga tantra aspect of Vajrasattva? The basic requirement is that you must be a serious, sincere practitioner, free from hypocrisy, and enthusiastically determined to attain the everlasting peaceful realization of enlightenment. You should be practicing what your teacher has shown you, not a misinterpretation projected by your own mind. In the experience of the yogis and yoginis in the Tibetan tradition, it's necessary that as a general qualification, you've received teachings on the graduated path to enlightenment in a perfect manner and have put them into practice. So, you know, some experience of the lamrim. As a specific qualification, you must have received initiation into the highest yoga tantra aspect of Vajrasattva. If you are so qualified, it's possible for you to actualize this practice. So he's talking about Vajrasattva, but we can extrapolate what Lama is saying here to any deity yoga practice. And, you know, in much of what he says would apply even to a long lamrim retreat, you know, not a non-tantric retreat. The reason that knowledge and experience of the graduated path to enlightenment are essential is that the three principal aspects of the path, renunciation, bodhicitta, and a correct understanding of emptiness, are indispensable prerequisites for the attainment of tantric realization. Without them, your practice of the yoga method will not be effective. It will remain superficial and intellectual and will never become one with your mind. If on this basis you receive the necessary, experience of the lamrim, intellectual knowledge and some meditational experience, if on that basis you receive the necessary initiation from a perfect qualified Vajra master, you are fully equipped to make a successful retreat on Haruka Vajrasattva, and you are most fortunate. Where to retreat? Where should a properly qualified person retreat? Not just any place will do. The ideal place to retreat is one that gives you a sense of reality, not one that is a big hallucination, a polluted projection of the deluded mind. Sometimes we're unwise. We try to meditate in a place that's like a furnace and complain when we can no longer stand the heat. A fire's nature is to burn. So if you stick your finger into a fire, then it'll get burned. It's up to you to choose the appropriate mandala for the way in which you want to develop, just like you should choose shoes that fit your feet. Of course, if you have great mind control, you can retreat anywhere. Your controlled vibration will even affect others. But if you are weak, the uncontrolled vibrations of others will affect you. Your small candlelight of wisdom will be blown out. In retreat, we try to gain control over our minds, but we're babies. With a long way to go. There you are, long way baby. We're babies with a long way to go. Baby minds need ideal conditions. Actually, our minds are worse than those of babies. Babies grasp at whatever they see, but we not only grasp at things we see, we intellectualize about them as well. As our wisdom is limited, we must put ourselves in the right environment. If our minds were free from confusion, we would have no need to worry about the environment. We wouldn't even need to retreat on Vajrasattva. It's very important to think carefully about the place in which you are putting yourself, not only where you're going to retreat, but also where you're going to live. Decide what you want to learn and live near where you can be taught. In Western cities, you can choose your environment quite easily. If you want to spend your time at the movies, you can live near a cinema. You have the freedom to do that. In other words, you have some control over your karma, the way your life develops. You're not powerless. Through your choices, you create your karma. If you want to retreat, you arrange the circumstances accordingly. That is creating karma. In the Lama's experience, the ideal place is a beautiful, natural environment where the atmosphere is quiet, peaceful, and relaxed. You can see snowy mountains, and there are wildflowers, medicinal plants, pleasing natural smells, and fresh, clean water. So, you know, that Chara Cave where I was, or Lado in general, meets all those criteria. Avoid places that are dirty, close to roads, traffic, and people. Environments that are dangerous and those where poisonous plants grow should also be avoided. Do not retreat in a place where you automatically feel insecure and nervous. So, you know, up there in Lado, it's, you know, there's nothing to fear. You know, even the visa police don't come up there to see if you've got a visa. And, you know, there's no crime. It's just, it's a perfect place to retreat. Nowadays, I think you're even allowed to retreat in Lama Zopa Rinpoche's cave. You know, he goes up there very rarely these days. You know, it used to be every year back in the 70s, pretty much. But yeah, I can't even, I don't remember exactly the last time he was there, but I think you're allowed to retreat in his cave, which would be an unbelievable blessing, you know, would be, you know, such a perfect place. And then it's, there's a gate that closes off from the other buildings, and there's a kitchen. There they would bring you food. Rinpoche's sister is been running, has been running the place for almost since it was built. It was built in 71, just soon after Rinpoche came back to Nepal after being in Tibet for 3 years and then being in the refugee camp for about 10 years. Places where holy beings live are excellent. They have a good vibration that I'm sure Westerners who are very sensitive can feel. And there is, there's a cave or two caves in that area where Milarepa meditated. It's quite close to Tibet, you know. So I don't know if we can identify those caves. There was one that was pointed out, but it was rather small. I don't know. I don't know if Westerners have ever tried meditating in the Milarepa's caves. Such ideal places are usually very isolated. In Tibet, we used to study in the monasteries and qualify for retreats, as explained above, and then go to an isolated place to meditate. These places were extremely simple, not like the Western luxury retreats, to which rich people escape when they do not want to meet anybody. Westerners really know how to enjoy themselves, even in isolation. However, it's all done out of self-cherishing. Ascetics retreats are exactly the opposite. Many Tibetan yogis would abandon the world for years or even a lifetime to in order to ensure perfect retreat conditions. Some even sealed themselves into doorless caves, receiving food through a small hole in the wall. So I think Milarepa was sealed into a cave like that for a year, I think, to meditate on impermanence by his guru Mapa. And so there was a little kind of stream or some water running through his cave that he could use as a bathroom. And he stayed in there for at least a year. You can also retreat in a monastery or at a Dharma center. In the East, many meditators used to retreat near cemeteries. Such places are usually quiet, but then they say they're also frequented by spirits. You build your hut away from the part of the cemetery frequented by visitors, and with deep understanding of impermanence and death, retreat. So choose carefully. The best place is one in which you feel secure in the knowledge that from beginning to end, there'll be no distractions. Of course, there's no real security in our samsaric lives, but somehow you should feel that the place you've chosen is as good as it is possible to find, and that you'll be able to retreat there effectively. So this is all stemming, all these talks are stemming from verse 40, thus maintaining well the conditions mentioned in the collection for meditative stabilization chapter by Bodhibhadra. Place the mind on any one virtuous focal object. So this is, we're trying to develop calm abiding. So as Sangha Rinpoche said, if we're well prepared, if we have good understanding of the lamrim, the three principal aspects of the path, renunciation, bodhicitta, right view of emptiness, and we've settled our worldly affairs, at least for the time being, and we have faith in karma, and we've received the right teachings from qualified teacher, and we have all these six conditions, the right place, the right food, water, so on, then we might be able to achieve calm abiding in 6 months. So anyone game to try? Okay, so I think that's, didn't really do that much today, did we? Still, time flies when you're having fun. Okay, so thanks very much, everybody. I have serious doubt whether these talks benefit you much, but it really helps me a lot to occasionally think about Dharma, as I have to for this couple of hours. So I really appreciate the opportunity. So we'll continue, hopefully, next week. And we've created a lot of merit, I think, reading these teachings from the holy gurus, and we generated bodhicitta at the beginning. So really, there's a lot of merit to dedicate. What does Alex call it? Network for. Anyway, the networks for total enlightenment or something like that. We've created a lot of merit. So let's dedicate that to the enlightenment of all sentient beings. Because of this merit, may I quickly reach enlightenment for the sole purpose of enlightening all sentient beings. So that should always be our motivation and our goal. We'll just do the concluding prayers. Thank you, Bob.
Saji perki juxing me to tram re rabding geni degin padi sange shindu mikte owagi drokon mambak shing lacher parshug. Jetun lame kutse rapten ching nam katrin le chokshur ge padang lo sang ten pedrin me sasum gi droe mun self hak tu negur chig idam guru ratna mandalakam niryatayami. In that snow mountain encircled land, source of every benefit and joy, may Lord Tenzin Gyatso Chenrezig remain in life till samsara's end. Savior, the snowland teachings and transmigratory beings who extensively clarifies the path that unifies emptiness and compassion. To the lotus in the hand, Lord Tenzin Gyatso, I beseech, may all your holy wishes be fulfilled. You who uphold the subduer's moral way, who serve as the bountiful bearer of all, sustaining, preserving, and spreading Manjuna's victorious doctrine, who masterfully accomplishes magnificent prayers honoring the three jewels, savior of myself and others, your disciples, please, please live long. Through this virtue, may I swiftly, having gained Guru Buddha's state, place each and every sentient being without exception in that state. Precious Supreme Bodhi Mind, may I where unborn arise and where born never decline, but increase forevermore. Gang chen ke pe su gen song ka pa lo sang rag pe jab la sol wa de. Thank you, Nick.
Yeah, thanks again, everybody. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you, Nick.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Bob. Thank you,
Nick.
Good week.